In this video help, I'm going to discuss the Equipment Ad Portal. Now, this equipment data portal and service is a part of the Equipment Ad Portal in that the record that is kept here is already being created as an asset. In other words, you should be in the asset management screen when you create the base file for this particular piece of equipment. Now, the reason that this screen is here is this is where you manage the service and maintenance of the item, and a little bit more information that is provided when you issue the piece of equipment. This screen has, for example, the serial number, and I'll talk about this information in a second here, but there's some other fields that are used when you were in the calendar. You saw, for example, the equipment type. Well, that information is basically done in this screen. Let's consider what this screen is also used for. When you're billing a item that is out where it's actually being used as an equipment where you're going to be billing a client or you're doing service where you're going to build the service and the materials, then that needs to have a screen where that work can be done. And this is that screen. Basically, if you're looking at it on the drop-down menu, you'll see that it's called the Equipment Ad Service. That's what this screen is for. So what we're going to do, it's equipment add and service combination where you're adding a service record. Now, this equipment up here when you look at it has to be unique. And how can it be made unique? Well, in the equipment asset screen, all the equipment assets that you put into that screen have their data brought over from the assets to create what was ultimately a service record. Now, what's going to happen if you try to pick this a second time? It needs to be unique and only one record for the history of this particular piece of equipment that you're using in the asset management. So if you try to pick it again, you're going to get an error where it pops up and said, this item has already been used and it needs to be unique. The first thing that tells you is that there is already a record in the service records. And if you needed to add a record, were you going to come up here to add it because it was not available, you would add the record, then pick it from the list. But what happens normally when you have an item that is created in the asset list, the next thing you should do is bring this information screen up, put the information in that's required here, and that way it is there and the picture is there and all that other information that you're required for later on is there. Let's go by field so we can understand how this particular screen works. Since we're here coming from the app map, we do have the same do app or action drop down over here, and we also have the next and previous if you want to cycle through the records. For example, I can do next, and now I'm looking at a case tractor, and I'm trying to show that the records in selection that you currently have, if you've done a find, may be different than the records that were the total number of records in there. And one way you can find out is you can look in here, and it'll show all the records, and if you look at the probability of having all the records in there or not having them in there, it might be because somebody has done a find. You will guarantee they're all there if you click on the show all records. Now there is a delete button in here, but I tell you very cautiously, do not delete. This is in here in case you have done something where you've created a child record and it doesn't need to be in there and you need to take it out. That's about the only time you would want to use this. Currently, the way I've set this up, you shouldn't be able to create a new piece of equipment in here because it's supposed to be unique. But sometimes people do stuff and get around it somehow, and you do have the ability to delete a duplicate record if that's required. Let's go down through the fields. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to pick, let's say we're going to pick the tractor. The next thing that's going to happen is that this thing is part of an equipment pool, or it's a equipment for deposit, or you know, whatever, it's the equipment type basically which you want to put in here. But you can add and edit that list by clicking on here. The equipment type could be something that you might want to have different groups of equipment list items, and you can do that by actually creating the name of the item and put it in like a group thing like we did for the T for tractors. You can put in here a group, for example, maybe you want IT stuff. You could create one IT and then have items that also have IT in them, but they're all based on things that are in an IT type of environment. So you can do that in the list if you want to. And this does have a pop-up screen that allows you to edit that list. The next thing is the manufacturer, in this case, is you actually have some of this data come over when you drop it down and add it from the record from the asset management. One of the things it should do is bring a manufacturer. It may not or may have the serial number. You want to put the serial number in there. What the serial number is required for is that it separates if you have a number of pieces of equipment that you can find which one this is based on the actual serial number that's in here. That distinguishes it among these identical same items. The equipment purchase date, that should have come over from the asset management record. Now, interestingly enough, I have a little thing in here that some people that are asset managers would understand immediately. The equipment age in days, put in today's date in here, it'll calculate the amount of days of its age. The purchase cost came over from the asset record, but this is also the age in months, 31.10. Now, this has some things to do with useful life of a piece of equipment. Once an item is being depreciated on an ongoing basis, the serviceable life of a piece of equipment is just a finite thing. It could be for so many years, like 5 or 6 or something like that. Well, what this allows you to do is to understand, since you purchased the item, was it new when you got it, or was it old when you got it? So, you know, or if you're, how long are you going to use it for is what it really breaks down to. If you think a serviceable life, you bought this item with 3 years on it, and it's only good for 6 years, then you're going to want to pay attention to these numbers. And then the base cost of the item should be depreciated over that period, so that when you get down to it, that the thing becomes actually worth zero as far as writing it off as far as a cost item when it gets so old. And this has a lot to do with the company managing their tax and how they adjust for tax for life cycles of items that they actually are using. Another part of this is if you understand the useful life of an item and it goes to its full life and then it dies, well, how long did it last? That starts giving you historicals on items that stay in here that when you go to buy something, you can anticipate if you had two of them and they died within 3 months of each other where they were no longer useful. That tells you how long you can anticipate this value will last for as far as writing it off. Equipment purchased from is something that should also come from the main asset calendar. Now we start doing things that are different. We're going to add a picture. We can insert a picture in this screen, which is a current picture of the device that is actually being put on the screen here and the asset. Because some are configured differently, you're going to want a current looking picture of the way that this product looks like. And that can be any kind of product that you might be using in your equipment asset management. If you're buying parts for this thing, you could have a list of vendors where you purchase your parts. And that could take quite a few of them in there. So you should have a full list of all the part brokers who can send or buy parts from. The next thing is comments about the particular piece of equipment. If there's something unique to this piece of equipment that is causing it to have issues or whatever, you can run this comment thing. For example, if you had, say, like a part that broke and you check with the manufacturer and found out that there's a warranty replacement, then that's something that would be important to know in each record where you have a like item. So you'd want to put that in here so you understand that that is an issue with this particular item. The notes is actually a pre-setup thing for the client type of situation that you're in right now. And this can be edited as well to give it the exact items that you want to have in there. Issue is an actual thing that may or may not be used. Some people, when they have an asset that goes out, there's a sequence of time. For example, it might be 24 hours, a month per day, plant equipment, week, and a year. You can add additional ones. Maybe it's a 90-day thing. What that's basically telling you, this thing cycles back in and out on a repetitive basis. If this item is going to be moved, delivered outside of your area for a compound, and it has to be moved, you can also set up a transport type. If this thing is a very heavy item and requires a certain level of a truck to carry it, like a 5-ton or a 10-ton, then you can put that in here. In this case, it says 2-ton flatbed truck, but you can put anything you need to in this particular area. If it's not going to have any issues as far as sending it, because it's a small item, then none would be appropriate for transport type. The equipment status as what the current status is for this particular item in the service area. It could be available, awaiting parts delivery and service, issued on hold, pending reservation, and so forth. You've seen these used throughout the application. So this is equipment status, and it may repeat on different screens. Now, one of the next things that's really important is that we're going to talk about service, but I want to point out just a few things on the screen. There is an equipment listing that you can get to, and this will be discussed separately. This is an add new record screen, so if you click on this, you're going to be able to create a new record in this screen. This button right here will take you back to the equipment main asset screen, but you can also jump right there by the app map and go back to the asset screen if you need to. Okay, let's talk about this area. This is kind of unique in this application. Even though this is an asset management system, this allows you to put together an equipment service plan. If you understand through the manufacturer's requirements that there is either a cycle of day, time, week cycles, or whatever kind of a thing where this thing needs to be serviced, you would go ahead and you'd put that in here. Now, this is picked by its serial number, so the leading thing up here is the serial number. So if you're going to create a plan record and you're going to put it in here, you should match the serial number here and the serial number for the drop-down. And you can see in this case, you're creating a equipment service plan for this item, so that's what you pick. The service work order will cycle automatically from the computer. Whatever the next work order task item number is will be put in this space, so you do not have to enter that in there. The next thing is the days of intervals. In the service plan, if it's every 83 days and you put that in there, and then you put a date from, which is the last time it was serviced, the next or that date or the next day would be the start of the new service plan. Now, if this thing is not in service, is not going to be used for a while, there are, and this is an old thing I knew when I was working as a asset manager, is that certain things have to be changed even though this thing could sit idle for a while. And you should stay within your rotation as far as your service plan is concerned. Even though it's not used every day, it may be sitting in a field or in a yard somewhere waiting to be used, there still is a forced kind of a schedule that you'd want to be using that relate to the cycle. So if you put this date in here, what it's going to do, if it's every 83 days intervals and you put this date in, it's going to calculate the next time it's supposed to be back in. So you don't have to do that and figure it out for yourself. The next thing is the type service. There is a type service screen in here where you can create the types of service that you're going to be providing. Scheduled, unscaled, scheduled, on-site, field repair. You may add things that are appropriate depending on the nature of the way you use your hardware and the type of hardware that you have. The next thing is the service description, and this is not a drop-down. This is something where you create service, plan maintenance, general check or service. It could be oil filter and change. It could be some kind of a seal that has to be replaced every so often. It could be an O-ring that has to be changed on a certain thing like a hydraulic lift arm or whatever. Whatever that plan requires as far as the manufacturer is concerned at the cycles, you can create the entire plan in here. The only thing you would not do is add the start date on certain items that were already sequencing. Or you could, if it requires it, set a sequence of events on 2.5 where other things are done on from 2.5 on the 4.29 date. And you can be adding those and adding the 2.5 to 4.29s, but they do different things. Like I said, there may be a scheduled service where you take a certain thing and you do it, and that would be in here, but all of those things might cycle on the same date period. Now, the way this is set up, the last thing that was done will go to the top of the list, so you're going to see the older items going toward the bottom as they cycle through. Service work order itself. Once you create the service order and you put the date in, the combination of the serial number and the date will be tied together to indicate what the actual service work order is, serial number and date for 429. And since this is service work order task number 14, where the tasks can change, you'd have this and the task number to know what actual task is being performed. So if you're doing something for a client outside and you're doing some kind of service, you could use this data on the invoice to pick out that certain item that you did as the service. The service by, this comes from the employee screen, which we talked about a little earlier. What this is you create an employee, you put their name in, and you put the kind of job that they do. Service shop tech, Ted Emerson is a service tech, and you can have whatever's required in there. What'll happen when you pick the name will go in, and the service tech or name of the person's job description will not show. The date would be appropriate. It came over on service work order 14 for the service date. The amount of service hours that are involved. The labor rate is based on the hourly rate, which is the first number. And then again, you would take Alan Jones, and that would tell you that that's Alan Jones's rate at $12 an hour. Now these in here, you have the option. These are unloaded rates, which is straight work hour time per labor. If you wanted to load these, that's your choice, so that you would have maybe a markup or margin on it as far as the labor hour is concerned. If you're going to do that, then you need to pad all employees with the type of approach that they're using, either loaded or unloaded rate. Once you put the sum of labor in here, it's based on the amount of hours that you actually do for the service and the labor rate. It'll automatically calculate the labor sum. Then the labor performed is nothing more than a description of what you did. Completed the service check, completed the such and such, or completed this, this, and this. And then if you had additional stuff on the work order, it would be the next item and so forth all the way down through until you do that. This provides you with a working service work order and a work plan. And the next thing is materials. Materials, once again, you pick the service work order, serial number in this case, which is the serial number for the case 4856, the service date, the used to service. Now, used to service is in some cases, it might be a item that is like an oil filter. So you might want to put oil filter and then the product description. It may be an X2375 oil filter. So you put that in and then you put description of the product, which is oil filter engine. Quantity of, the cost, automatically tells you the material sum when you put the quantity and cost in there. And then a note, and this is actually a scrolling thing, so you can actually add more data and scroll it if you need to see the rest of it, if there's a longer description of it. All this stuff would be put on the service work order invoice if you wanted to put it there. There is a portal in here where you can go and look at more larger description of the actual service. If you want to read this, it would go to that portal. The same thing occurs here, where if you wanted to go see the portal for that particular field, you would do it here. And note that up at the top, it gives you a summary of the equipment labor sum. This one would give you, in the actual working portal, it would give you the sum for this piece of equipment. On this one, there is no sum because this is a plan rather than anything else. And then the plan would be over here as a single record. So if you wanted to do a search on any of these that have portals in them, you would go to the individual record and then search by whatever fields that you want to bring up a report of that data. Now, there are other reports we're going to be talking about that are available. So you might want to just check those out before you start trying to do that kind of thing. They should be available to give you a itemized report, including the invoice itself that works as almost like a report because it shows you the services that were provided on this cycle on 2-5 for the 4-29 actual in-service date, due date. If you have any questions, as usual, you can always contact me through the ontargetsolution.biz support site under FAQ and put in a question if you have one. Thank you.